I'm truly honored and delighted to be able to welcome two incredibly talented authors tonight who will be in conversation with each other around the question, who belongs at home? And I'm going to introduce them one at a time. First, Kamila Shamsie. She was born in 1973 in Karachi, where she grew up. And until recently, she split her time between Karachi and London, but is now based primarily in London. She has a BA in creative writing from Hamilton College, where she has occasionally taught creative writing, and an MFA from the University of Massachusetts Amherst, a landscape that will be familiar to those of you who have read Home Fire. While at UMass, she wrote In the City by the Sea, which was published by Granta in 1998. This first novel was shortlisted for the John Llewellyn Rees Award in the UK, and Shamsie received the Prime Minister's Award for Literature in Pakistan in 1999. Her 2000 novel, Salt and Saffron, led to her selection of one of Orange's 21 writers for the 21st century. And with her third novel, Cartography, she was again shortlisted for the John Llewellyn Rees Award. Both Cartography and her next novel, Broken Verses, won the Patras Bukhari Award from the Academy of Letters in Pakistan. Burnt Shadows, Shamsie's fifth novel, has been longlisted for the Orange Prize for Fiction. Her books have been translated into many languages, but they also ask us to contemplate, through her complexly braided storytelling, how moving among languages, nations, communities, and historical periods shapes people and their understanding of a term that is central to us this year, kinship. Her page-turning novels delve into the deep past, exploring, among other things, how it is that people and things from the past lure those of us in the present to seek connection with them. And yet, at the same time, her novels are highly resonant with the present and our shared future, so much so that she was recently asked in a Channel 4 interview whether she was actually a soothsayer. Shamsie comes from a distinguished literary family and is herself a reviewer and columnist, primarily for The Guardian, as well as a frequent judge for literary awards. She sits on the advisory board of the Index of Censorship and is a vital voice in the public conversation about how we use culture and what the role of the writer in the world is today. So Kamila Shamsie, welcome to Philadelphia. Thank you for making this journey. And I want to let you all know that the books of both Kamila Shamsie and Emily Wilson will be out in the lobby for signed copies if you're interested in getting books. So Kamila Shamsie will be in conversation with Emily Wilson, who is a professor of classical studies and graduate chair of the program in comparative literature and literary theory here at the University of Pennsylvania. Wilson trained at the University of Oxford and Yale University and is, simply put, one of the most distinguished living scholars of classical literature. She is a brilliant and transformative translator who has, through her intelligence, knowledge, and adeptness in multiple languages, made a broad array of people care and think about and wake up to reading, language, and the past in truly remarkable ways. She exemplifies the best of the humanities, and that includes being critical of its worst features. She is a generous, creative, insightful, and very active colleague and teacher at Penn. In 2006, she was named a Fellow of the American Academy in Rome in Renaissance and Early Modern Scholarship. And very recently, in 2019, she was named a MacArthur Fellow, otherwise known as the Genius Award. And I want to congratulate her here. Please join me in congratulating her. She is the author of Mocked with Death, Tragic Over Living, from Sophocles to Milton, from 2004, The Death of Socrates, Hero, Villain, Chatterbox, Saint, 2007, The Greatest Empire, A Life of Seneca, from 2014, and she's also the classics editor of the third and subsequent editions of the Norton Anthology of World Literature and Western Literature. Her translations of classical literature make us think carefully about what happens when we move stories from one place in time and language into others. Most recently, her translation of Homer's Odyssey has brought her great acclaim, to put it mildly. I had the privilege of being in a year-long Humanities Center faculty seminar with Emily while she was working on this project in early stages, and it was just plain thrilling to hear her talk out loud about how she was thinking about the options she was toying with for each word and why she was choosing the words that she was choosing and what she hoped to achieve with this particular translation project. I'm just really delighted with the impact that it has had. Emily lives here in Philadelphia, as she says on her website, with three daughters and three cats, and we're most fortunate to share this community with her. So please join me in welcoming both of our speakers tonight.
I'm going to read a section from the middle of Home Fire. It's a novel in five parts, each from a different character's perspective. And this is from the point of view of a young 19-year-old man called Pervez, who lives in London, and is at this moment rather disgruntled. His sisters have gone off to university. He hasn't. He's working at the greengrocer's. The day before, he's been mugged and his phone was stolen. There is a deeper sense of dis-ease that he also has. His father was a jihadi who was captured by the Americans in Afghanistan after 9/11 and died on his way to Guantanamo. And he's grown up knowing that this is a very shameful past that he mustn't talk about. He's grown up in a house of women, his two sisters, his mother and grandmother. And his father has always been this taboo subject, which has been, let's say, problematic for him. And this is him one day, just after he's been mugged at the greengrocer's. Farouk found him the next morning, standing among empty crates around the back of the greengrocer's, trying to remove a splinter from his palm. "Assalamu alaikum," said an unfamiliar voice in the faux Arabicized accent of a non-Arab Muslim who is trying too hard. And Pervez looked up to see a compact but powerfully built man, muscles distorting the shape of his tightly fitting bomber jacket. Somewhere around 30 years old, with hair that fell in ringlets to his shoulders, offsetting a beard that was neither hipster nor ecosystem, but simply masculine. An instant glamour to him that excused all accents. He was holding out the tweezer component of his Swiss Army knife, a surprising delicacy in his gesture. Pervez took it and tried to capture the splinter, but his left hand felt clumsy and he kept pinching his skin instead. Without saying anything, the man took the tweezers from him, rested his hand beneath Pervez's to steady it, and plucked out the splinter with a flourish and a wink. Then he pressed his thumb against a drop of blood that appeared, staunching the inconsequential wound. "My Kutta cousin took something of yours. I apologize. He didn't realize who you were." He reached into a pocket of his combat trousers and handed back the stolen phone. "Who am I?" Pervez wanted to ask, but he knew the answer already. He was Anika's brother. When older boys, the kind you would die to be friends with, paid attention to him, it was always because he was Anika's brother. Anika never liked the ones Pervez tried to nudge her towards. She preferred the quieter boys she could boss around. "You know my sister?" The man looked displeased. "What are sisters to do with me? I know of Abu Pervez." "I'm Pervez. I don't know any Abu Pervez." "Don't you know your father's name?" "I never knew my father." This was what he'd been taught to say over and over by his mother and grandmother. There were whispers in the neighborhood about Adil Pasha, he knew, and one day in the school playground, a group of boys had accosted him to ask if it was true that his father was a jihadi who had been killed in Guantanamo. "I never knew my father," he'd replied weakly. The boys walked over to Anika and asked the same question. She shrugged and turned away, disdain already perfected at the age of 9. But later she whispered to the most loose-lipped of her friends, "It makes him sound like someone in a movie, doesn't it? More interesting than a father who died of malaria in Karachi." "He regretted that," the stranger said, "that you never knew him. He fought with my father. I heard all the stories of the great warrior Abu Pervez." "That wasn't my father's name. It was Adil Pasha. It was his..." The man said something that sounded like "num digger." "That's French for jihadi name. Superhero name is how I think of it, though some of the brothers don't like that. But yeah, your dad. When he entered the fight for justice, he called himself Father of Pervez. That was his way of keeping you close. So anytime someone said his name, his enemies with fear, his brothers with love, his comrades with honor, they were saying your name too." Horribly, Pervez felt tears come to his eyes in the company of a man who probably wouldn't cry if you drove a tank over his legs. But the man didn't seem to think any the less of him for it. Instead, he drew Pervez close in a cologne-scented embrace and said, "I'm glad I found you, brother." Berbés went home that evening with the incandescence of a beautiful secret in his heart. He did all the cooking, didn't take his plate off to the TV room when his sisters ate at the kitchen table, teased Isma about the American accent she would acquire in Massachusetts. "What's happened to you?" Anika said. And he had the satisfaction of having a hidden corner of his life that his sisters didn't know about. Thank you.
I'm wondering if you could tell us both about how you got the voice of that character, and also just about how does his experience of not feeling fully at home in London, is it that he doesn't feel fully at home in his family with his sisters? How does that relationship of being not at home in the household relate to not feeling fully at home in British culture, he doesn't get the opportunity to have a scholarship to go to university? There are all these different ways that he's alienated from both society and family. And then how does that experience result in thinking that this alternative home is going to be a better home, this fake brother who obviously doesn't actually belong either in Britain or somewhere else, but he wants that fake narrative?
I think the central truth of Berbés is that he doesn't feel at home in himself, which is what is the root of where other things start from. And he's a boy who grows up primarily with his sisters. His mother dies when they're quite young. And so he grows up with his twin sister and his older sister, Isma, who's 9 years old and is raising them, really. He grows up in a patriarchal world, which is to say he grows up in the world. His sisters are both stronger characters than him. He knows that. His older sister is the one making all the decisions about finances and everything else. His twin goes off to university and he's left behind. He's a fatherless boy who really wants a male figure in his life. And I think the key for me in unlocking the character was remembering what a friend of mine had said, and it's a line I think I steal for the book, which is, if you're a boy, for a boy, your father is your guide into manhood. And so I thought of Berbés as someone who doesn't have that and who has this sense that maybe he's doing masculinity wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, and it doesn't help that he is surrounded by these strong women. Mm-hmm. And in some ways is very comfortable with them and very comfortable with women, but there is this wound and this anxiety. Mm-hmm. And this sense of being out of place because they're all women. Where is the male figure?
Mm-hmm.
And even sort of the closest friends across the street are women.
Mm-hmm.
And so there is this vulnerability in him that he just needs someone to come along and say, I'm going to teach you how to be a man, mm-hmm. in the way your father was. Your father who you don't need to be ashamed of. I'm going to tell you how to be proud of him.
Mm-hmm.
And part of what is going on is a lot the reason for the wound is precisely this fact that his sisters and before that his mother said, we mustn't talk about our father. And that has to do with the societal alienation, mm-hmm. which is that if it's known that your family, that your parent was this extremist Muslim,
mm-hmm.
then you are going to be judged for it. And society is, you know, constantly telling you certain things, mm-hmm. about being a young Muslim man. And I was very lucky when I was writing the play that a writer who I greatly admire, who's also a friend, the writer Julian Slovo, mm-hmm. was commissioned by the National Theatre in London to do a play on young Brits had become radicalized. And she went and spoke to some completely unradicalized young British Muslims in London. And when I read the first draft of the play, there was a bit I was particularly struck by, which is she was talking to this 16-year-old, a group of sort of 15, 16-year-old British Muslim Londoners, London was their home. They were very clear in that. They had no other home. But the way they were viewed, mm-hmm. was often as outsiders. And there was this young man who was very articulate and smart. And he talked about being on the tube, on the London, you know, underground metro, mm-hmm. One day. And it was quite hot and he was wearing a backpack. And as many of you will know, that there was in 2005, you had these bombings on the London Underground by these young British Muslim boys who were carrying the bombs in their backpacks. And this was some 12 years later. And this young man said that he was on the tube, it was very hot. He had his school blazer on and a backpack. And so he took off his backpack so he could remove the blazer. And he suddenly became very aware that he had made the people around him uncomfortable. And he felt very bad for making them feel scared. And then he felt, but all I've done is take off my backpack. Why should that be a problematic thing? And that, I thought, that something in that, the sense of, you see, it's not that you don't see yourself as belonging to this place, but you see other people as seeing you as not belonging to this place. That so often this question of identity is formulated as, these people don't feel that they belong. But so often it's these people want to be seen to belong, and other people, the majoritarian culture, is saying, but not exactly.
Yes, I mean, as you were talking, I was realizing how your novel is so much focused around these very strong female characters, and there's this vulnerability that's there in the all three of the main male characters. There's both Parvez, but also the politician figure who is advocating for British Muslims to totally assimilate with British culture and give up a lot of their Muslim identity, which of course is about exactly what you're articulating, of that you can only fully be British if you're not fully Muslim, that in fact you can't be both those things, and that there's a vulnerability that comes with that, and then there's a vulnerability that comes also with the son of the politician's desire to assume that, of course, all his privilege is natural, and then the terrible realization that some of it might be fragile in some way.
I was sort of interested in this, in sort of looking at these five characters who are all in some way identifiable as British Muslim, although they, to various degrees, may or may not identify themselves. And saying the son of privilege, Eamon doesn't think of himself as that at all. You know, his mother's Irish-American, he can pass. And he has incredible class privilege in a way his father didn't. So, you know, and there's that way in which class does, to a certain extent, lift you out of certain kind of prejudices, but then you hit that moment where it doesn't. And then it also becomes that question of kinship, that he is able to not be Muslim as long as he surrounded himself with people who are not Muslim. And once he goes and becomes involved with someone who is and who identifies himself, his whole sense of how he's seen and where his affinities are and how he's going to view other people viewing him and viewing his girlfriend, it just all gets turned on its head.
Now, can you talk about the relationship between the two sisters? I mean, I think in a way, because I would also love to hear about what you're doing with Sophocles and what kind of kinship does your text have with the earlier model of the Antigone. I mean, it seems to me that you make Sophocles' Ismene is, I think, a much less interesting character than your Isma, with whom we start the novel, who's the older of the two sisters. And I guess I would like to just hear more about the process of coming up with that vision of what is the relationship between those siblings, and how are they both, they're both British Muslim women, they both wear the hijab, they're both strong in their identity and they're able to inhabit multiple different worlds, but they're also very clearly distinguished from each other. And I think it's something I would just like to hear about, how did you envision them as being both in some ways so similar and also so radically different from each other?
Well, the similar was they are the same family, and that one has essentially raised the other.
Yeah.
So that, you know, Anika is sort of this model of how to grow up comes from her sister, but there's also that's who you're going to rebel against. So I think that's a very sort of familial thing of that coming together and the moving apart. But in terms of Antigone, because for those who missed it, the play, the novel started with Antigone. It is... it's not a rewriting of Antigone, but Antigone, it sprung out from Antigone in various ways. And to me, in Antigone, that opening scene, which is these two sisters arguing about what to do, about the fact that their brother, the king has said, the tyrant has said, that their brother's body will not be buried as a punishment for him having rebelled against the state. And one sister says, I will bury my brother's body, and the other sister says, no, we're women and it's the law, we can't do anything. to me, what was crucial, and it's so interesting when you're working with translations, mm-hmm. because I don't actually know what Sophocles did mm-hmm. with that play. You can tell me later. Because I read a number of different translations, and there were different shades of meaning and mm-hmm. emphasis in all of them. And with the Anne Carson translation, and I apologize to those who were in the class earlier today who've already heard me say mm-hmm. that, but in the Anne Carson translation, there was a very striking moment to me, which is when Antigone, when the two sisters are arguing, and Ismene has basically said, I'm not going along with you, you can't, you know, to bury our brother's body, just don't do it. And Antigone gets very angry with her. And then Ismene sort of, you know, is sort of evincing concern for her sister, mm-hmm. and Antigone says, you know, what do you care, essentially? You know, you've chosen, you're not with me, what do you care? And they know that the possible punishment is death mm-hmm. for disobeying the law. And in Carson's translation, Ismene has a very simple, straightforward response. I'll be so lonely. Mm-hmm. And everything for me came from that mm-hmm. here, actually, this is not about Ismene being the compliant one, the mm-hmm. one who says, no, we can't shake the boat. She's the one who's saying, our parents are dead, our brothers have just died, and now you want to get yourself killed. You are the only family I have left. I need you to be alive because you are all I have. And if mm-hmm. you're not here, I'll be so lonely. Mm-hmm. And the really interesting thing when the book came out mm-hmm. for me was Natalie Haynes was mm-hmm. reviewing it, classicist, and she says, and Shamsie switches the birth order and makes Ismene the older one. And I thought Ismene was the older one, because to me she was so obviously an older sister. Mm-hmm. Because I have an older sister, and I know that I'm more likely to say the impetuous, you know, this is what we must do, and my sister will be, her response would be to look out for me. And to keep me safe, and who cares about what is just and what is right? I have to keep you safe. And I was talking to my friend Ali Smith, who'd done a version mm-hmm. of Antigone, and I said, Ali, you ought to change the birth order. And she said, what do you mean? Are you saying as many? She's so clearly so. Yes. So a lot of it was this great, wonderful lack of knowledge on both our parts, was as many as this total responsible, I have to keep you alive, older sister. Mm-hmm. And that is very much how I saw it, is the Antigone figure, Anika, is all grief. Mm-hmm. She's just pure grief. So I don't actually, in the way that Antigone is often seen as this figure of justice and civil mm-hmm. disobedience, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I mean, at a certain point, she's able to articulate things, but she, when she's asked her reasons for why she's burying mm-hmm. her brother's body, she gives you about six different reasons.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And yes. It is that thing of, it's because the... her real reason is beyond words. It is that primal no. Mm-hmm. No, you can't leave my brother's body above the ground for the dogs to tear apart. How can I allow this? Mm-hmm. And so then when she's asked, why are you doing this? She gives this reason, that reason, this other mm-hmm. reason. But it's just because it's no.
Yes. I really love the way that in your novel, Isma is the one who's studying sociology and doing a PhD, that she's the one who wants to have the whole picture of society and why is it that mm. British Muslims are treated this way. Yeah. Whereas Anika, she's actually much more of a creature of the moment and of impulse, and she has all these very, very intense feelings, and that it's much more about that for mm-hmm. her. I'm curious just about the process of, did you feel that this is an adaptation? Did you grapple with, should I keep Eteocles in there or not? Because, of course, there's a second brother in Sophocles' play, and there isn't a second brother in your novel. Yeah. I mean, was that kind of thing present for you? I mean, did you sort of think, okay, so Creon has a wife, so I have to develop a character that's going to be the wife? And I think you actually did a wonderful job in creating, or was it a different process than that?
So the process was, the novel has to stand on its own, so I have to be willing to dispense with whatever in the play isn't useful. And I actually thought I would get rid of a lot more than I did.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a surprise to me, actually, how much of that play just, you know, because what I did was read about four or five translations, then put it away mm-hmm. and say, now I'm just going to write the novel, and mm-hmm. was surprised, actually, about how much of the play kept coming mm-hmm. up in it. And so it was very clear to me that I would get rid of, and that two brothers, that actually the other one doesn't serve a purpose.
Doesn't do much, yes.
Too much
yes.
to get rid of him.
Yes.
The one thing I knew was that Creon's wife was going to be more of a woman in her own right
yes.
than in the play, where she's so, actually her name is Teresa because she is the Tiresias figure.
Yes.
mingle
yes,
with.
Yes, that makes sense, yes.
Right.
Yes.
So it's sort of, let's take these two and put them together in some way.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, it's a great joy of the novelist doing the very freewheeling, not even adaptation, it just, you know, it started with Antigone, let's see where we can go, is that you really, you have no fidelity whatsoever to Antigone.
Yes.
Your entire fidelity is to the novel.
Yes, of course. Yeah. I mean, obviously it's very different from the process of being a translator, but to me it was also striking how much of Antigone you have in the novel, and also then thinking about your other novels, how I feel like I look at those differently, having read Homefire and seeing that all the themes of Antigone were already there even when you weren't doing Antigone. That in fact those themes about belonging to more than one community, about conflicts between a larger community and a smaller community, between a family tie and different kinds of family tie, that in fact whatever Sophocles is writing about was always what you were writing about, it seemed to me. So I guess I would like to hear about whether you felt Homefire was a departure from your earlier work, or is it somehow part of the same trajectory? Because you hadn't used an earlier text in quite that very close way ever before. And yet it seems to me that there's this very close resonance between each of your novels before Homefire and then Homefire.
It is. I mean, I seem to, for some peculiar reason, I do come back a lot to this question of loyalties and competing loyalties, or what you might call is different forms of kinship.
Yeah.
And the reason that the play Antigone became a novel was precisely because there was so much in it that was resonating with things I was interested in.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it wouldn't have happened.
It wouldn't have worked. I mean, I think there are so many adaptations of classical myth out there, and I think some of them are actually a little bit plodding because they're just, the goal is just to adapt a myth, and look, I've adapted a myth. And it seemed as if your novel actually has this drive which comes from the things you're already caring about.
Well, it was so interesting, the timing of it, because the way it happened was there's a theatre director in London who emailed me and said, come and meet me for a coffee. And I was at that moment where I was looking for the next novel to write, but I had no idea what it was.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to meet him and he said, write a play for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I don't know how to write a play.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I thought you'd say that, so okay, why don't you adapt a play, because then someone else has already written it. And how about, you know, the Greeks are having a real revival in the theater, something like Antigone.
Mm-hmm.
He said something like Antigone or the Oresteia in a contemporary context. And and the Oresteia sort of came and went from my brain, and I found myself saying, oh, Antigone, that's really interesting. What I was thinking was, which one is Antigone? Because it's a terrible thing to say in such an audience, but I had studied it as an undergraduate and remembered nothing of it whatsoever. So I said, well, that's interesting. And then I got on the train to go back home, and literally, again, horrible thing to confess, went on Wikipedia to look at plot summary. And this was in September 2015. Islamic State had declared its caliphate some 2 or 3 months earlier. And about 3 weeks prior to this, Theresa May, who was then the Home Secretary, or so in charge of domestic terrorism and citizenship issues, had said, any British citizens who go off to fight in Syria, wherever we can, we will strip them of our citizenship. And I was looking at, and the newspapers were full of these stories every day. And there were also occasional stories of families, of sisters being interviewed about this brother who had left. And I'd been very struck by that, and I'd been very struck by her saying, we will take away their citizenship, because I had very recently become a British citizen. Mm-hmm. And I didn't realize it was contingent and could be taken away if you were a dual citizen or if you had a claim to a second passport. So these were things that I had really very, very carefully been looking at, but I didn't know how they would become a novel, or really I wasn't aware that I was trying to find a way to make them a novel. And when I was looking at that plot summary of Antigone, my first response was, no, I can't tell this in a contemporary context, because central to Antigone is the idea that the ruler is saying, here's this traitor's body and we will not bury it.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, you're not going to do that in 2016-15 Britain for hygiene laws, let alone anything else. It's not that anyone's more civilized now, but for hygiene laws, you're not going to leave a body above the ground for the dogs. And then I thought of Theresa May and what she'd mm-hmm. said. And I thought, well, what when you're saying to someone, we will strip you of your citizenship, mm-hmm. what are you saying? You're saying you have no claim to this earth. Mm-hmm. And in fact, one of the consequences of being stripped of your citizenship is you lose the right of a citizen to be buried in the country of citizenship.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I just thought, oh my God, this is it. This is, and it was, I mean, I do really remember it as this moment, and this may be memory playing tricks with me, but suddenly realizing that I had been reading these articles and thinking about it and questions around citizenship and belonging and what happens to the families that stay behind and what it is with British Muslim, and I just, in Antigone, found the hook to handle mm-hmm. it.
It's amazing, yes. So, I mean, obviously, the Antigone is a very ancient play, and yet it has this resonance with contemporary Britain, as well as, I think, in fact, with other contemporary societies as well. Mm-hmm. And I guess I would like to hear more from you about the past in your work, and how I think a lot of your work, even beyond Home Fire, has this very, very deep interest in history and in earlier moments, and how do they resonate with later moments? How do we get from then to now? And I was really interested by your narrative of how it seemed as if the past of the Antigone, this is a very alien culture, but yet it seems actually to be almost like now in some way or other. I mean, so maybe you could talk about how does that work in any of your other books as well. It seems like there's God in Ruins is a historical novel which traces this grand imperial history through multiple different points of view. Broken Verses is also tracing a relationship between the past and the present.
I mean, I've always been profoundly interested in history, and I've always felt that it is both a source of comfort and of terror that we are continually inhabiting the same stories. Mm-hmm. We keep going back to them, and there's a comfort in that because it is, you know, one of the reasons why it was so useful to me to use Antigone is when ISIS happened and young Brits and young Europeans were going off, everyone was acting as though something entirely new had happened in the world. Mm-hmm. We don't know how to respond to this. We must create new laws. We have to have new conversations. You think, nothing new here. There is nothing new. This is a very old story. They are always very old stories. And my interest is in narrative. I mean, and as you know, these stories, whether it's the Odyssey, whether it's Gilgamesh, it's wonderful. They recently, I think was it last year, there was a new fragment of Gilgamesh. Mm-hmm. It's wonderful how with Gilgamesh there always is new fragments being found. And the one that pops up last year is an elaboration on Gilgamesh's destruction of the forest, which is like a climate change moment because it is seeing just the horrors of that destruction and how the gods will be angry because why have you done this thing? And you just think this is perhaps the oldest story we know, and it comes to us, this new old fragment lands at this moment when this is the primary story we're telling to say this has always been the story. Mm-hmm. We have always been doing this. We have always been living it, and we have always heard the voices of warning to say that's not what you should be doing. Mm-hmm. And so I've always felt so deeply that sense of resonance, which is also about connection, you know, because whether your stories are from ancient Greece, whether your stories are from Babylon, whether your stories are from the Indus Valley civilization, we are telling the same stories, we are living the same stories. But why do we keep living the worst parts of them, even though the stories are out there telling us, that's the wrong road, buddy.
Yes, yes.
Don't go there, don't anger the gods. Very simple one, Odyssey.
Yes,
right? But no, we will. We'll do it. Hubris, etc. But it also is that, you know, when I grew up, the stories that I loved the most were, in fact, the ancient Greek myths. And one of the great joys of my life, and I must have been 6 or 7, was my mother had given me one of those, you know, little penguin, those sort of ladybird books, Alexander the Great, and looking at the route of Alexander's navies and armies and realizing, oh, he came through Karachi.
Yes.
He came through where I lived. You know, and this whole idea of the Greeks being Western civilization, you know, and it goes back to kinship again. Someone said to me, you know, so you've taken Greek tragedy, this sort of foundational thing of Western civilization to tell a story about these Muslims and, you know, Syria mm-hmm. and all that, and now you're playing with it. And I said, there were Indo-Greek kingdoms in India for 200 years. That's as long as the Brits were there. Mm-hmm. The first woman to appear on the coin of India was an Indo-Greek queen called Agatha Clare in around 100 BC. Mm-hmm. There are pieces of Gandhara art which show what we think is a scene from Antigone, mm-hmm. you know, which is in Peshawar, in mm-hmm. what is now Pakistan. Mm-hmm. You know, that, and this sense of these worlds coming together, mm-hmm. and they always did, because that is, if you love anything to do with culture, mm-hmm. culture has always looked around and said, what can I take? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, now we use appropriation as a bad word, but actually there is a generosity as well, in the sense of, how can I adapt to you? Mm-hmm. How can I take from you? How can you augment what I already am? What can I learn from you? Mm-hmm. And so for me, there's nothing more beautiful in the world than Gandhara art, which is a fusion of the Greek, the Persian, the Indic, mm-hmm. Which then went and influenced Chinese art and Japanese art. Mm-hmm. You know, and you have these great Greek toga-like things, mm-hmm. And these Indian features, except even as I'm using that language, I'm caught up in the fallacy of thinking that says, mm-hmm. this is Greek and this is Indic, mm-hmm. because Gandhara was all these things. Mm-hmm. And so I've always just loved that, and I've always loved, and I don't know, maybe it has to do with growing up in Pakistan, but with half my life or more of it spent in books written in the English language, mm-hmm. which were therefore set somewhere else, mm-hmm. and with a grandfather who would quote Greek onomatopoeias mm-hmm. around the dining table, while my grandmother would be sitting with her brother reciting Urdu and Persian couplets. And figure, I mean, I'm making this family sound ridiculous, it's not what we do all the time. But because my love was language, you know, there were these different languages and there mm. were these different stories, and that is just how the world has made sense to me, is to go mm. back to those old stories and the stories from different places and to bring them together.
Mm-hmm. So beautiful. Karen, is it time to have Q&A? I was wondering if, are we going to... Okay, good. Yes, I just don't want to make sure that the audience doesn't get totally cut off. So, I mean, I think if Home Fire is presented as a novel that's about a radicalized Muslim, then it sounds very political, and I think in a way your novels are very political. Mm-hmm. But I would like to hear about, I mean, if you say this novel is political, it can sound as if it's making a stump speech, which I don't think you're making. I mean, that you're actually inhabiting the different worlds of the different characters, mm. but through doing that, you are making particular kinds of cultural intervention within mm. the life and the mind and the imagination of your readers and our culture.
Mm. It's interesting to me that, because I've gone around to different countries with this book mm-hmm. and with previous mm-hmm. novels, and there are countries where the phrase, where the term political when attached to a mm-hmm. novel, there's always some anxiety around it.
Yeah.
And there are other countries which recognize life is political.
Yeah.
You know, that there is no distinction. And I think actually now in countries like America and Britain, you're seeing it more, that there's mm-hmm. it's impossible to pretend that is what is happening in the political realm is irrelevant to people's lives, or mm-hmm. that it's happening somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Any woman who's ever wanted an abortion knows that the political is not in any way separate mm-hmm. from the personal in this country, and in many countries. And you know, when I grew up in Pakistan, it was 2 years after a civil war. It was 4 years before, I was 4 years when there was a military coup. Mm-hmm. I was 6 when a prime minister was hanged. I remember, some of my earliest memories are the day Bhutto was hanged when I was 6 years old. But because I was 6 years old, the way I remember it was I was in school, and a close friend of my parents who had sons at the same school mm-hmm. came to pick us up early because they'd heard that the democratically elected prime minister had been hanged by the military dictator. They were expecting trouble in the streets. Mm-hmm. And because he lived closer to the school than my parents did, they had called him up. And he had come to pick up his sons, my sister and me, from school and take us home early. And to me, it was the most thrilling thing to be sort of mm-hmm. in the middle of the school day, kind of leave the school and be driven home to your friend's house so you could sort of play. And I arrived there, and my parents were there, and I didn't know what was going on. And then my father said, Bhutto's been hanged. Mm. I was 6, I remember this. And then I remember that because of the trouble that followed, we had school was shut. Because my uncle was a pro-democracy politician, he was under house arrest, and we had to get permission from the government to go and visit him. These are the stories of my childhood. Mm-hmm. They are political stories, mm-hmm. but it's not about stump speeches. It's not a polemic. Mm-hmm. It's just a recognition that what is happening in the realm of the political mm-hmm. is so entwined with how people live their lives and what they are allowed to do and what mm-hmm. is legal to do mm-hmm. and what is transgression and what is normal. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But I was sort of struck in my translation of the Odyssey, I felt that some readers seem to respond as if it's illegitimate to present this poem as a political thing. If you make it clear that it's about society in too vivid a way, then it's too political. Yeah. Which I think is especially that your novels are political partly because you make the people so real. Mm. And the people are real across different divides. And that once you do that, that's inevitably in some way or other a political thing to do and in a very reasonable way. Yeah. And that you can sort of hide the essentially political element in communities or in societies, or you can make it visible that people belong to different communities and that that's actually a dangerous as well as essential element in our lives.
I think that says it very nicely.
Okay. Yes.
It goes back, it's my interest in politics is my interest in history, and my interest in history, my interest in politics. It's sort of that overwhelming question of how do we survive history? Mm-hmm. And what bits of us don't survive it? Mm-hmm. And maybe in part, you can always try and work out the reasons. And, my grandparents lived through partition, the partition of India and Pakistan, and half the family stayed in India and half the family stayed in Pakistan. So to me, that's a family story. Partition is a family story, but it's also a story of we don't even know how many, a million killed, tens of millions displaced. Mm-hmm. It is a huge political story. We don't, how do you tell it? But if you're a novelist, you just go to one family and say, well, look at what happened here. Mm-hmm. And this is, it's like a tiny chink of light on a very large canvas. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is what the novel does. Mm-hmm. And you just try and have enough of the chink of lights that it allows you not only to see what that little bit of the canvas that you're shedding the light on, but to get people to try and imagine what is surrounding it. Mm-hmm.
So I know you're working on a new book. Can I ask you a little bit about what it's about? I mean, what kind of setting it has?
I wish I knew. I'm 3,000 words in.
Oh.
So I'm really kind of unsure about very much of it. I think it seems to want to do multiple locations again.
Mm-hmm. It seems like something you do.
First four novels were all set in Karachi within about a mile or two of it's a city of about 20 million people, but my novels are all set in, one square mile. And then, you do a thing a certain amount of time, and then you want to do something completely different. So then I just went into these much larger kind of canvases, but I expect that's also to do with the fact that I started doing the larger canvases and I moved to Britain, and I'm aware of these different locations in my life, that Pakistan, America, because I spent a lot of time here teaching and studying, and Britain are all places that have been formative for me, and that it's so interesting that as you move from one, I suppose it was really post 9/11, it was a very dramatic moment that, because I was in London on 9/11, 6 weeks later I was back in Karachi, and 3 months later I was in upstate New York teaching. And you just find that you can, because you've lived in these three places, you completely understand the angle of history at which everyone is approaching these same moments. But you also see a lot of people not understanding that other angle of history. And what that's like to sort of shift around and have that same moment being talked about and thought about in these very different kinds of ways. And that is a novelist's terrain, which may be why, since, if there's one line that the novelists I love quote more than any other, it's John Berger's, "Never again will a single story be told as though it were the only one." Mm-hmm. And I think increasingly in my work that there is a lot of that, that what is so interesting to me is how we are living in the same moment, but we are not living in the same story. But except, of course, we are living in the same story. And what that means.
How did you arrive at the title Home Fires?
How did I arrive at the title Home Fires? So I'm terrible at titles. There's nothing I'm worse at the titles, except wrapping gifts, which I'm really awful at. I can't do that. But it's not really required in my professional life. So I have many working titles, or as I refer to them, not working titles. Every draft has a different not working title. And with Home Fire, it was a Friday, and my editor said, we have a catalog going to press on Monday, which is generally how I come up with a title. And I was talking to a friend of mine, and she said, well, what a pity that the fire next time's already been used, because that would work very well for your novel. She'd read it. And I said, yeah, thanks. It did get me thinking about fire. And you know, I was sort of sitting and thinking about what are different things you can do with fire. And I came on Home Fire, and what I liked in there was that duality. On one hand, you have, of course, keep the home fires burning. So it becomes about home and welcome and the familial. And on the other hand, it's a house on fire. And the way that there are both those things going on in the novel, within the families and within the country. So that sort of tension in there. Because I did want it to be a novel that is both, that has a warmth as well as a conflagration to it.
One of my favorite things about the novel is how people are self-deceiving, sort of, and how people are unable to understand the motives and the ideas that their family members are working with. I wanted to know if you had any more comments about that. And I was also, I guess I want to complain, I wish there'd been a little bit more about the home secretary's wife, who seemed to be the one who had everybody's number. And I liked that about her.
I don't think she had everyone's number. I think she had his number. And again, you know, I would have liked, but there are things where you think, as a novelist, there are things I would like to do for me, but within the structure of a novel, she played the role she did. And again, maybe it was because I was seeing Antigone and how Tiresias really comes in that late and does something very significant. You know, has a significant role to play. And so what I wanted for her was not for her to be some wispy, shadowy character. I wanted you as the reader to have precisely the reaction you do of knowing this is a real substantial person of significance. It's just that within the particular telling of the story, she is more in the shadows than not. And partly because he has to keep her in the shadows. Because if her husband was telling her what he was singing and doing, she would have probably set him right, and then the novel wouldn't have happened, right? In the same way that Isma, if she had known what her sister was doing, it would probably have been very different, so she had to be kept away also. Sorry, what was your question before that?
Self-deceit.
Oh, self-deceit. I think there's a tremendous amount of self-deceit, but we know about self-deceit, and we all know that we can't really see ourselves. What I was interested in even more than that was the other thing you mentioned about knowing other people. Because so often when I was reading the accounts of family members who's had a brother or a sister or a son being radicalized, you would very often hear in a way that felt, that really did ring true, them saying, but he used to be, he was always this loving boy, the sweet boy, he was all, And I was thinking about the fact that, and also that there was a really chilling but interesting detail that for a lot of these young, primarily men in the beginning, but later also some young women, the time it takes for radicalization, the time between first contact with the recruiter and going to Syria was often less than a month. And I thought, if you live with someone, if you grow up with someone, you have this conviction, I know them. Mm-hmm. I know what they're capable of. And so I don't have to worry about certain things. And yet, particularly when at a certain kind of very vulnerable mm-hmm. age, when people can behave impetuously, when, you know, I mean, think of love. You know, there is a point in the novel when there's a comparison made between that recruitment process and love, that how quickly and dramatically it can take over things and make you behave in ways that a few weeks earlier you wouldn't have imagined behaving. Mm-hmm. And this sense that because you live with people and you think, I know them, you actually fail to see what is very radically happening. Mm-hmm. You think they're going through a phase, but I know what they're really like. But while they're in that phase, they might do something extreme. And so that not knowing of the people around you, or the thinking you know them and getting lazy because you knew who they were 3 years ago, and this idea we have that people don't change, which both is and isn't true. People don't change, but the we have within us competing traits all the time. And sometimes a trait that was kind of in a minor key can suddenly become much, much louder. Mm-hmm. And that was what was really so interesting to me, was in this novel how people, they're not seeing themselves, but they're really failing to see each other. They're failing to see the people they think they know the best.
Hi. Antigone is a play that I think has been adapted probably to different political contexts more than maybe other, mm-hmm. or like the Oresteia, as you said, which yeah. is kind of more of a personal drama. And this is kind of, if it's a family drama, it's on a political stage. And I just wondered whether you were thinking, or whether you looked at any of the other kind of adaptations of Antigone, like during the Troubles in Ireland or in South Africa, a post-apartheid South Africa, and whether you think there's something kind of fundamental to this play that makes it very adaptable to different, and particularly to like to post-colonial contexts as well. So I just, and how that relates to, say, Muslim characters in your novels and British imperialism from countries that were post-colonial. So yeah, sorry.
Thank you for that question. I didn't look at the different adaptation just because I wanted to, and that's why after the very initial stages, I barely read anything anyone had written on Antigone, because I just wanted to do my version without looking at what other people had done. But I was very aware that there were these other. There's a great story of, because of course Athol Fugard did the one in South Africa, which is about sort of ANC prisoners performing Antigone. I don't know if Fugard knew at the time that, and I don't think he did, that in fact when Mandela wrote his memoirs, one of the things he talked about was how when he was in Robben Island, he and the other ANC prisoners put on a performance of Antigone. Mm-hmm. And Mandela brilliantly played crayon. Mm-hmm. But he writes, but of course, we were all Antigone. Mm-hmm. I think Antigone, and Emily is obviously going to know a lot more about this, but I'm going to just sound off for a while. I think Antigone has a particular resonance in the 20th century. When Thoreau coined the idea of civil disobedience, he invoked Antigone, right? He talks about her. The 20th century really was a civil disobedience century. And whether you think of Mandela, whether you think of Martin Luther, whether you think of Gandhi, right? It was many of the heroes of that time. And Antigone was very much a civil disobedience figure, the one who says justice rather than the law. What I think is so interesting is the way in the 21st century, she's been flipped a bit. It's in that adaptability of it, and you see it in the Seamus Heaney translation, The Buried at Thebes, which I did see, which I did read, and which was written quite soon after 9/11, where he has Creon saying a line that is virtually an echo of George Bush's, you're either with us or against mm-hmm. us. And Carson also talks about when Antigone is basically walled up. It's like being in Guantanamo. You're not in a prison, you're not free, it's this in-between state. And so that Antigone then became this different kind of figure, mm-hmm. Or the play became a different kind of figure, and it became, and I think now it speaks to us a lot because we're so interested in this idea of the relationship between the citizen and the state. And what do you do when the state behaves in ways that are lawful but not just? You know, and you see Antigone's everywhere. The teenagers who stood up to talk about gun control, to me, those are very much Antigone figures. Greta Thunberg, in her own way, is an Antigone figure. This idea of this young woman who is speaking truth to power, who is saying, you governments, you laws, you're not fit for purpose. You're not what we need. So I think she's being translated and interpreted in that really interesting way right now. But I think because she can be seen as this figure of the individual who stands up to the powerful, I think that is what makes her such a strong figure in all these different countries and contexts.
Yeah, so I have a question. I hope I'm able to articulate it clearly, but it's about the question of radicalization in your novel. So on a very kind of superficial level, if you were to ask me what is this novel about, I might say that there's a kind of young orphan boy who becomes a radical Muslim. And yet, when we look at, we see a kind of range of radical steps, radical decisions, radical acts that are driven by a certain kind of passion, I think, in a lot of the characters in your novel, but that sort of very mediatized idea of radicalization as being the function of a particular religious ideology is not really present. So I wanted to ask, the question essentially is if you could talk a little bit more about maybe the way that your novel problematizes that notion of radicalization, and if you can speak a little bit more about what is sort of what, speak a little bit more about what is that passion or what is that attachment that's driving persons to take particular radical acts.
There was a really interesting report by MI5, the British Intelligence Services, when all these people were going off to join ISIS, where they were sort of analyzing it. And there was a fascinating thing that came out of it, which was they said, we can't find a common denominator. Some are young, some are older. Some are happily married, some are single, some are middle class, some are working class, some have good jobs, some have no jobs. They said, if there is one feature that comes up more than others, is that they don't have particularly religious backgrounds. Which, first of all, struck me as very surprising, and then sort of made sense because the ISIS version of Islam is so out there, is so extreme that even for people who I might think are quite conservative slash even extreme in their views, even for them, that is really way out. And if you'd grown up with being told this is your religion in most households, it wouldn't represent, I mean, it wouldn't look like that ISIS version. And so if someone came along and said, this is Islam, you'd say, that's not what my parents told me, my uncle told me, my grand, that's not how we, that's not an Islam I recognize. So it's people who in some way are drawn to an idea but don't actually have a basis in that, don't have a foundation in it. There was that great story, horrifying but great, of the young men who were going to Syria, taking along a book with them called Islam for Dummies, right? Which I think is quite telling. But more than that, it was when I was thinking of Pervez and how to conceive of him, I was very indebted to the work of a researcher called Charlie Winter, who looked at ISIS propaganda, so that I didn't have to, because I really didn't want to, who looked at ISIS propaganda from the early days of the so-called caliphate. Later it changed. I think later it became much more violent, according to him. But in the early days, when what they really wanted was to establish a Caliphate, they wanted a nation. If you want a nation, you don't just want people who want to come and fight. You want people who want to come and live there, right? So you are trying to attract people to say, you're doing a propaganda of this is why this is the greatest place for you to live. And he analyzed all the propaganda over, it was either a month or 2 months, and broke it down into what are they selling. And something like less than 10% of the propaganda was violence related. And not a huge amount was specifically Islamic law, although that was there. But the thing that came up most often in the propaganda was sense of belonging. Mm-hmm. More than anything else, was sense of belonging, nation building. So you can come here and do something significant. Lack of racism. Mm-hmm. Lack of racism and attached to that, you can be a Muslim without anyone looking down on you for it, you know. And it was actually looking at what ISIS was using as its propaganda that I was able to come up with a story of what was used to get at this particular young man. And because I was interested in the story of someone who is not a fanatic, who is not drawn to violence, who doesn't want to go out and kill a lot of people, and yet still goes, and yet is still drawn. Because in fact, that propaganda was really terrifyingly complex and nuanced and effective. Because what I saw looking at the Charlie Winter story was, they know how to create a really good story of this nation. Mm-hmm. You know, and so I wanted to tell the story of who is the boy who is going to be drawn to all these things, to sense of belonging, to nation. And of course, the one thing, though, that you had to be drawn to is a place without women. Mm-hmm. Because if you look at, you know, the propaganda, that women, if they appear at all, are just invisible objects. But also what was very striking, I did see one video. I didn't want to see any of the beheadings or any of the way in which they were using people's death and suffering as a form of getting into your head and of propaganda. But there was one video they'd done on the occasion of Eid, the Muslim holy day, which was extraordinary because you had these incredibly beautiful young men. I mean, so good looking. Young men of all ethnic backgrounds saying, come here. This is great, we're so happy. And literally you have men riding down on horseback down a street. Mm-hmm. You have men sitting together, men playing together, men having a great time. No women, but very good looking young men, all saying, this is fantastic, this is mm-hmm. so much fun, come and be part of this. Mm-hmm. It was chillingly, mm-hmm. chillingly well done. Mm-hmm. And I thought, who is the boy who is going to be drawn to mm-hmm. that?
I think I hadn't realized before how Parvez is characterized so much by his love of music. Mm-hmm. And in fact, he's the boy who's so good at listening. Yeah. And he's able to listen to this story. And mm-hmm. that's the vulnerability that comes both with having been raised by the sisters, but yeah. also being able to hear.
Yeah. Yeah.
That hearing can be yeah. this dangerous, vulnerable thing.
And of course, the other thing that they did was, you know, because they needed people with technical expertise. Mm-hmm. So it's also, you know, you're a young man, you can't get a job, university doesn't want you. Come here and we pay you. The media technicians were paid more than the fighters mm. and had nicer houses to live in. Mm. You know, so it's also that there was a transactional element to it of mm. this is what you can have here. You really want to carry on working at the greengrocers in London?
Mm-hmm. There are a few things that really reading across your works I thought were interesting threads. And one of the things I noticed was that you often have a character who's got a very goofy sense of humor mm-hmm. And who questions, it's often a female character, questions her own humor and wonders about it, but it seems like a device that allows you to do certain things. I wondered about that. But another thing that I see is prevalent across many of your novels is the presence of spaces like cultural institutions, like universities and museums, mm-hmm. with characters often having an ambivalent relationship to those mm-hmm. museums. They are vehicles to the past, but they are also spaces of exclusion and spaces of violence. And I wondered if you could just talk a little bit about those two things.
Yeah, I have such complicated relationships to museums. The British Museum is one of my favorite places. Should all those things be in there rather than back where they came from? It's such a sort of fraught question. I want the Elgin marbles, as we like to call them, rather than giving them the real name, to be where I can go and see them. But of course, they should be in situ. But also, of course, a lot of people should see them. And when I was in Peshawar, I went to the Peshawar Museum, which has the world's largest collection of Gandhara. And there is something about seeing these artifacts where they were created. But I'm also very glad that there is enough Gandhara in the world that it can also be in museums, in the Jime, it can be in the V&A, it can be in the British Museum, and that these things can be shared around. But you know, these institutions, and particularly things like museums in the subcontinent and other places, were very much part of an imperial narrative. And that's problematic. So much that is interesting is problematic. There are these institutions that often have their own rather malign purposes, but they are utilizing and harnessing stuff that has extraordinary potential. And how do you work your way through all of that and around all of that? You know, which is another way of saying structures that we live in are problematic, whatever they are. The structures of government are problematic, the structures of society, the structures of museums, the structures of anything. That there are, where you have structures, you have hierarchies. That's always going to be problematic. So what do you do with it? But there are also spaces that allow transgression. I'm always interested in looking at that. And partly it is because of my own very complicated responses that, oh, but I want to go and see this. Oh, but it shouldn't be there. Oh, but, you know, it's so wonderful that all these people can come and see it. Whereas in Peshawar, how many people go to the Peshawar Museum? You know, when I went, it was empty. More people were going to the Peshawar Museum in 1930 during British rule than are going now. And so it's really, so much around it is fraught. On humor, I've always liked humor. And I've always, you know, it's funny, when I was in grad school at UMass and I was writing a novel which was about a young boy in a military dictatorship. And every so often someone in the class would say, I don't understand why they're laughing when things are so terrible. And I'd say, because that's what people do. That is, that the idea that there's this peculiar notion that if you are making a joke, it means you're taking something lightly, which is the most ridiculous idea I've ever heard. If you're making a joke, you're trying to impose control on something. You're trying to not be scared of it. I mean, not all jokes. Sometimes you're trying to make light of it. But the really deep jokes, and certainly the jokes you tell in scary times, are you're trying to assert, you're trying to not be terrified. And I think that's a lot of the way that humor will often function, is that people are, I mean, sometimes they're using it because they want to charm someone. Eamon in Home Fire, just, you know, for him, it's a form of being charming. It's a social skill. But there are other times when people are using it as a way to say, I'm not scared, I'm in control. You know, at least I can laugh about this. I'm not going to give it the serious, I'm not going to allow it to terrify me in the way it wants to terrify me, which I think is how many of us do use humor.
In your portrayal of like racialized and heavily politicized characters, do you feel any responsibility given that you know a large portion of your audience may be, for example, reading this as the South Asian story or the Muslim story of, you know, for example, of a young male Muslim in a Western country? How do you go about sort of balancing your creative process with also knowing that your audience may orientalize, in a sense, what you are writing about?
So first of all, when I write, I never write down to an audience. I never assume that my audience is going to know less than I am, that they're going to be bad readers, that they're going to read a novel and think this is the world. That's not how, I wouldn't know how to write that. I write assuming, I don't have an ideal reader, but if there's a kind of reader that I have to pitch to, it's one who knows more than I do about everything I'm writing, including how to write. Having said that, all representation brings with it responsibilities. But you have to be, you know, most of writing is what is happening in the back of your brain, and it's what you already know and how you already see the world. I'm not going to write a Muslim character who is going to play into someone's bad stereotypes, because why would I? That's not how I would conceive of a character. That's not good writing. There are always going to be people who will read it in ways you didn't intend. The novel allows for that. The novel has to allow for that. But you have to, at a certain point, you know, writing does involve both a lot of humility and a certain degree. I don't like to use the word arrogance, but you have to, but that's probably what I mean. You have to trust yourself. You have to trust that you're not going to write the stupid thing. Mm-hmm. And you have to trust your readers. And sometimes you'll be wrong to trust your readers, but that's not the reader you can write for. You can't write for the reader who's going to come in wanting to find their worst stereotypes confirmed. Because they can. They always can. Because a novel has to allow for a multiplicity of interpretation. But that's not who, that I'm not going to sort of start putting in signposts in a novel to say, no, you can't read it this way. Because that would be a really awful novel. And I do trust the form of the novel to carry complexity and nuance and to reward it in a way that it won't reward stereotype and simplification. If what I'm interested in as a writer is the complexities around these questions, if what I'm interested in a writer is the injustices of history, then those things are going to come out, I have to believe, in the work, without me sitting down and saying, is this sentence going to be read this way or that way? It will, there will be, there are people who read it in ways that are not how I see it at all. But I've written a novel, and if I had wanted to write a polemic that could only be understood in one way, I would have written a polemic, and sometimes I do. You know, I mean, there are times when I'll write nonfiction of a certain sort because there is a point I want to make, and I'm going to put everything into getting you, the reader, to try and follow me in this point. That's not what I can do as a novelist.
How did you come to the decision of ending the novel in that way, and how much of Sophocles played a role in that?
So we're not going to give away the end of the novel. all I'll say is it's a really interesting thing with novels is when you start off, the beginning, anything can happen. Your characters can go here, they can go there. They can fall in love, they can not fall in love, they can stay friends, they can go for dinner together, they can go scuba, whatever. Mm-hmm. Anything can happen at the beginning of a novel. The closer you get to the end, the more you're closing off options. Mm-hmm. And that the ending is always, it's certainly always been true for the novels I write. It is the only version of the ending that feels right. And I often don't know what it is until I'm right there. With this one, I didn't, because as I said, I was perfectly happy to jettison whatever in Sophocles wasn't making sense for the novel. And I've had it happen a couple of times that I've had to trick myself into writing the endings that I've written, because at a certain point, you're living with your characters, you want only nice things to happen for them. So I have, with two of my novels, I have tricked myself into thinking that I'm going to write an ending where everything is okay for everyone. And then just at that final chapter, I realized, not going to happen. That everything is leading up only to, there's a certain moment at which your ending becomes inevitable, and there is nothing you can do as a writer about it as much as you want to do something else. You have written yourself into that point, and if you try and write any other point, you can feel the falseness coming off the page.
So I'm sorry this ending is inevitable, because I think we could talk all night. It's been a really fantastic conversation, so please join me in thanking Kamila Shamsie and Wilson.